Okey, başlıyoruz then. The Tales of Beedle the Bard. O zaman Beedle'ın hikayeleri adı bence daha güzel. Söylemesi daha çok sarıyor. Güzel resim. By J.K. Rowling. Başka hiçbir şey yok mu okuyacak? Hani yok. Hayret diyoruz. İşte büyücünün sihirli kütüğü mü ne bir şey. Neyse onu da okurum zaten şimdi. Evet, in. The Tales of Beedle the Bard diyoruz. Okey. Titles available in Harry Potter series in reading order diyor. Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, done. Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, done. Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban, done. Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, done. Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, done. Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, done. Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, done. Titles available in the Harry Potter series in Latin. Are you fucking kidding me? Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Latin okumadık. Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets'ini okumadık. In Welsh, Ancient Greek and Irish. Are you fucking kidding me? Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Not done. Other titles available. Foolish Through the Ages. Done. Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Done. Okay. The Tales of Beedle the Bard, translated from the original runes by Hermione Granger, by J.K. Rowling. Diyor. Children's High Level Group Health Education Welfare. İngilizce kitap okuyorum. Gerçek İngilizce kanalı Bloomsbury. First. Ben bunu tam şey etmiş miyim ya? Şöyle tam sığsın. Tam sığması buymuş zaten. Okay. First published in Great Britain in 2008 by the Children's High Level Group. 45 Great Peter Street, London. SW1P3LT in association with Bloomsbury Publishing Place, 36 Soho Square, London, WB1D3QY. Text and illustrations copyright. J.K. Rowling 2007/2008. Bunu da şey yani Deathly Hallows'u 2007'da yazıyor. Ondan sonra direkt bunu yazıyor herhalde. The Children's High Level Group and the Children's High Level Group logo and associated logos are trademarks of the Children's High Level Group. Okay, gittik tamam anladık. The Children's High Level Group, CHLG, is a charity established under English law. Registered charity number 111-2575. J.K. Rowling has asserted her moral rights, all rights reserved. No part of this publication may be reproduced or transmitted by any means, electronic, mechanical, photocopying or otherwise, without the prior permission of the publisher. A CIP catalog record of this book is available from the British Library. ISBN 978-0-74-75-99-87-6. FSC, mixed sources product group from well-managed forests and other controlled sources. www.fsc.org. Certification SGS COC 2061. Copyright 1996 Forest Stewardship Council. The paper on which this book is printed has copyright 1996 Forest Stewardship Council AC FCS accreditation. The FCS promotes environmentally appropriate, socially beneficial and economically viable management of the world's forests. Tebrikler. Type set by Refine Catch Limited, Bungay, Suffolk. Printed in Great Britain by Clays Limited, STIs, PLC, Place sanırım. 1357910642. Bakın bu sayıları çözeceğiz bir gün. www.chlg.org www.bloomsbury.com/beedlebard. Gittik. Okey. Yeter artık. Bu da şey. Ölüm yadigarları pelerin kuru kafa asa ve taş. Okey to. Okey to. Okey to. Contents. Introduction. 11. 1. The Wizard and the Hopping Pot. 3. 2. The Fountain of Fairy Fortune. 21. 3. The Warlock's Hairy Heart, part 45. 4. Babbity Rabbity and Her Cackling Stump, 63. 5. The Tale of the Three Brothers, 87. A Personal Message from Baroness Nicholson of Winterbourne, MEP 107. Okay. Okay. Niye bombarsın? Introduction. The Tales of Beedle-the-Bard is a collection of stories written for young wizards and witches. They have been popular bedtime reading for centuries, with the result that the Hopping Pot and the Fountain of Fear Fortune are as familiar to many of the students at Hogwarts as Cinderella and Sleeping Beauty are to muggle, non-magical children. Beedle's stories resemble our fairy tales in many respects. For instance, virtue is usually rewarded and wickedness punished. However, there is one very obvious difference. In Muggle fairy tales, magic tends to lie at the root of the hero or heroine's troubles. The wicked witch has poisoned the apple or put the princess into a 100 years of sleep or turned the prince into an değil mi orada bir en aradım ben, hideous beast. In the tales of Beedle-the-Bard, on the other hand, görüyorsunuz değil mi? Bakın, we meet heroes and heroines who can perform magic themselves and yet find it just as hard to solve their problems as we do. Bu konuda şey diyesim geldi. Altıncı kitapta Other Minister diyordu ki, Other Minister diyen, asıl minister olduğunu düşünen İngiltere ministeri diyordu ki Fudge'a, ama siz büyü yapabiliyorsunuz, olayı çözsenize diyordu. Fudge öyle gülümsüyordu, diyordu ki problem is onlar da yapabilir. They can do too. Yapıyordu falan. Bu geldi aklıma. Beedle's stories have helped generations of wizarding parents to explain this painful fact of life to their young children, that magic causes as much trouble as it cures. Another notable difference between these fables and their muggle counterparts is that Beedle's witches are much more active in seeking their fortunes than our fairy tale heroines. Asha, Teda, Amata, and Babbity Rabbity are all witches who take their fate into their own hands, rather than taking a prolonged nap or waiting for someone to return a lost show. The exception to this rule, the unnamed maiden of the warlock's hairy heart, acts more like our idea of a storybook princess, but there is no happily ever after at the end of her tale. Beedle-the-Bard lived in the 15th century, and much of his life remains shrouded in mystery. You know that he was born in Yorkshire, and only surviving woodcut shows that he had an exceptionally luxuriant beard. If his stories accurately reflect his opinions, he rather liked muggles, whom he regarded as ignorant rather than malevolent. He mistrusted dark magic, and he believed that the worst excesses of wizard kind sprang from the all too human traits of cruelty, apathy, or arrogant misapplication of their own talents. The heroes and heroines who triumph in his stories are not those with the most powerful magic, but rather those who demonstrate the most kindness, common sense, and ingenuity. One modern-day wizard who had very similar views was, of course, Professor Albus Percival Wulfric Brian Dumbledore, Order of Merlin First Class, Headmaster of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, Supreme Mugwump of the International Confederation of Wizards, and Chief Warlock of the Wizengamot. This similarity of outlook notwithstanding, it was a surprise to discover a set of notes on the tales of Beedle-the-Bard among the many papers that Dumbledore left in his will to the Hogwarts archives. Bu durumda bu ön sözü Hermione'nin yazdığını anlıyoruz gibi bir şey. Yani ben daha yeni anladım. Devam. Whether this commentary was written for his own satisfaction or for future publication, we shall never know. However, we have been graciously granted permission by Professor Minerva McGonagall, now headmistress of Hogwarts, to print Professor Dumbledore's notes here, alongside a brand new translation of the tales by Hermione Granger. Hermione Granger değilmiş demek ki önsüz yazan. We hope that Professor Dumbledore's insights, which include observations on wizarding history, personal reminiscences, and enlightening information on key elements of each story, will help a new generation of both wizarding and muggle readers appreciate the tales of Beedle-the-Bard. Thief's Curse geliyor mu gelmiyor mu? Bekliyoruz. Gelirse bu sefer ben de sana söyleyeceğim çünkü J.K. Rowling. It is the belief of all who knew him personally that Professor Dumbledore would have been delighted to lend his support to this project, given that all royalties are to be donated to the Children's High Level Group, which works to benefit children in desperate need of a voice. It seems only right to make one small additional comment on Professor Dumbledore's notes. As far as we can tell, the notes were completed around 18 months before the tragic events that took place at the top of Hogwarts' astronomy tower. As far as we can tell, the notes were completed around 18 months before the tragic events that took place at the top of Hogwarts' astronomy tower. Bu durumda Dumbledore'un öleceğini bildiği için Hermione'ye, Harry'ye, Ron'a püfürü işte o zaman bildiğin kelimce bırakmak için 1,5 sene önceden falan hazırlanmaya başladığını ve belki de hazırlığını bitirdiğini falan görüyoruz. Bu güzel bir detay. Hani bu detayı vermesi demek J.K. Rowling'in yaklaşık 1 sene boyunca kendisi ölmeyeceğini düşünerekten çalıştı. 1 senede İşte öleceğini anladı. Yüzü taktıktan sonra eli zarar gördü. Çerçürt. Öyle. Hani buradan şu an bir yere bağlayamıyorum ekstradan. Ama güzel bir zamanı varmış. Erken başlamış Dumbledore çalışmaya. Onu fark ediyoruz yani. Hani her şey sıkışmamış. Erken başlayacak akıllılığı edebilmiş diyelim hazırlık için. Kendi ölümünden önce gerekli bilgiyi ve eşyaları gerekli insanlara verme olayını. Those familiar with the history of the most recent Wizarding War, everyone who has read all 7 volumes of On the Life of Harry Potter, for instance, will be aware that Professor Dumbledore reveals a little less than he knows or suspects about the final story in this book. The reason for any omission lies, perhaps, in what Dumbledore said about truth many years ago to his favorite and most famous pupil. It is a beautiful and terrible thing, and should therefore be treated with great caution. Whether we agree with him or not, we can perhaps excuse Professor Dumbledore for wishing to protect future readers from the temptations to which he himself had fallen prey, and for which he paid so terrible a price. Çok büyük bir laf ettiğini hissettim. Şu an bir kere daha okuyacağım. Whether we agree with him or not, we can perhaps excuse Professor Dumbledore for wishing to protect future readers from the temptations to which he himself had fallen prey and for which he paid so terrible a price. Hani Dumbledore'un kendi hatalarından dolayı çektiği acıların sadece Dumbledore'un kendisi tarafından terrible price olarak ifade edilmesi gerekirmiş gibi geldi. J.K. Rowling sen kimsin de Dumbledore'un yaptığı hataların sonucunda yaşadıklarının terrible price olarak ifade ediyorsun gibisinden bir soru oluştu kafamda. J.K. Rowling bana dedi ki ben Dumbledore'un yaratıcısıyım falan birazcık yaptı bana böyle. Okay, you win, Jesus. J.K. Rowling 2008. Anode on the footnotes. Professor Dumbledore appears to have been writing for a wizarding audience. So I have occasionally inserted an explanation of a term or fact that might need clarification for Muggle readers. JKR diyoruz tekrar. Ben şunu bir tık yaklaştırsam mı, yaklaştırmasam mı? Yaklaştırmıyorum. Okay. One. The Wizard and the Hopping Pot. Okay, resmimiz bu. Pek bir şey anlamıyorum. Sürüklü böcekler, yıldızlar, whatever. There was once a kindly old wizard who used his magic generously and wisely for the benefit of his neighbors. Rather than reveal the true source of his power, he pretended that his potions, charms, and antidotes sprang ready-made from the little cauldron he called his lucky cooking pot. Noel Baba'nın sağlık dağıtan versiyonu gibi bir şey. From miles around, people came to him with their troubles, and the wizard was pleased to give his pot a stir and put things right. Put things straight demesini de beklerdim ama right demiş, devam. This well-beloved wizard lived to a goodly age, then died, leaving all his chattels to his only son. Ama oğlu boktan herifin önde gideni göreceğiz şimdi. This son was of a very different disposition to his gentle father. Those who could not work magic were, to the son's mind, worthless. And he had often quarreled with his father's habit of dispensing magical aid to their neighbors. Upon the father's death, the son found hidden inside the old cooking pot a small package bearing his name. He opened it, hoping for gold, but found instead a soft, thick slipper, much too small to wear and with no pair. Hemen geliyorum. Devam. A fragment of parchment within the slipper bore the words, "In the fond hope, my son, that you will never need it." The son cursed his father's age-softened mind. Then threw the slipper back into the cauldron, resolving to use it henceforth as a rubbish pail. That very night, a peasant woman knocked on the front door. "My granddaughter is afflicted by a crop of warts," so she told him. "Your father used to mix a special poultice in that old cooking pot." "Begone," cried the son, "what care I for your brat's warts?" And he slammed the door into the old woman's face. At once there came a loud clanging and banging from his kitchen. The wizard lit his wand and opened the door, and there, to his amazement, he saw his father's old cooking pot. It had sprouted a single foot of brass and was hopping on the spot in the middle of the floor, making a fearful noise upon the flagged stones. The wizard approached it in wonder, but fell back hurriedly when he saw that the whole of the pot's surface was covered in warts. "Disgusting object," he cried, and he tried firstly to vanish the pot, then to clean it by magic, and finally to force it out of the house. None of his spells worked, however, and he was unable to prevent the pot hopping after him out of the kitchen and then following him up to bed, clanging and banging loudly on every wooden stair. The wizard could not sleep all night for the banging of the warty old pot by his bedside, and next morning the pot insisted upon hopping after him to the breakfast table. Clang, clang, clang, when the brass foot of the pot, and the wizard had not even started his porridge when there came another knock on the door. An old man stood on the doorstep. "'Tis my old donkey, sir," he explained. "Lost, she's or stolen. Without her, I cannot take my wares to market, and my family will go hungry tonight." "And I'm hungry now," roared the wizard, and he slammed the door upon the old man. Clang, clang, clang, when the cooking pot's single brass foot upon the floor, but now its clamor was mixed with the braise of a donkey and human groans of hunger, echoing from the depths of the pot. "Be still, be silent," shrieked the wizard, but not all his magical powers could quieten the warty pot, which hopped at his heels all day, braying and groaning and clanging, no matter where he went or what he did. That evening there came a third knock upon the door, and there on the threshold stood a young woman, sobbing as though her heart would break. "My baby is grievously ill," she said. "Won't you please help us? Your father bade me come if troubled," but the wizard slammed the door on her. And now the tormenting pot filled to the brim with salt water, and slopped tears all over the floor as it hopped and brayed and groaned and spruited more warts. Though no more villagers came to seek help at the wizard's cottage for the rest of the week, the pot kept him informed of their many ills. Within a few days, it was not only braying and groaning and slopping and hopping and sprouting warts, it was also choking and retching, crying like a baby, whining like a dog, and spewing out bad cheese and sour milk and a plague of hungry slugs. Hani resmimiz var lan. Okay. Şu ayakkabı çizimi çok eskiden bir tane masal kitabımız vardı. Böyle bayağı kaliteli bir şeydi. Cildi millik kalın. Böyle bir resim vardı. Üstünde oradaki kişinin ayaklarının çizimi tam bu tarzda çizimde. Bu tarzın adı ne bilmiyorum. Bunları İngilizler kullanıyor ama. Yanlış tahmin etmiyorsam. Aynı çizim tekniğini görüyoruz. Bir değişime gitti. Böyle bayağı bir geçmişe uçtum bir anlamda. Güzel. Good. The wizard could not sleep or eat with the pot beside him, but the pot refused to leave. and he could not silence it or force it to be still. At last, the wizard could bear it no more. "Bring me all your problems, all your troubles and all, and your woes," he screamed. He screamed, çok komikme gitti. Fleeing into the night, with the pot hopping behind him along the road into the village. "Come, let me cure you, mend you and comfort you. I have my father's cooking pot, and I shall make you well." And with the full pot still bounding along behind him, he ran up the street, casting spells in every direction. Inside one house, a little girl's words vanished as she slept. Dalos Blanky was summoned from a distant briar patch and sat down softly in its stable. The sick baby was dosed in Dittany and woke well and rosy. At every house of sickness and sorrow, the wizard did his best, and gradually the cooking pot beside them stopped groaning and retching and became quiet, shiny and clean. "Well, pot," asked the trembling wizard as the sun began to rise. The pot burnt out the single slipper he had thrown into it and permitted him to feed it onto the brass food. Together, they set off back to the wizard's house, the pot's footstep muffled at dust. But from that day forward, the wizard had the villagers like his father before him, lest the pot cast off its slipper and begin to hop once more. Zorla iyilik yapmış gibi bir şey olmuş. Okay diyoruz. Albus Dumbledore'un The Wizard and the Hopping Pot. A kind old wizard decides to teach his hard-hearted son a lesson by giving him a taste of the local muggle's misery. The young wizard's conscience awakes, and he agrees to use his magic for the benefit of his non-magical neighbors. A simple and heartwarming fable, one might think, in which case one would reveal oneself to be an innocent nincompoop. What the hell, Dumbledore nincompoop? Bilmiyoruz. A pro-muggle story showing a muggle-loving father as superior in magic to a muggle-hating son. It is nothing short of amazing that any copies of the original version of this tale survived the flames to which they were so often consigned. Biddle was somewhat out of step with his times in preaching a message of brotherly love for muggles. The persecution of witches and wizards was gathering pace all over Europe in the early 15th century. Many in the magical community felt, and with good reason, that offering to cast a spell on the muggle next door's sickly pig was tantamount to volunteering to fetch the firewood for one's own funeral pyre. It is true, of course, that genuine witches and wizards were reasonably adept at escaping the stake, block, and noose. See my comments about it. Said that the Lapin in the commentary on Babbity Rabbity and her cackling stump. However, a number of deaths did occur. Sir Nicholas de Mimsey for Pinkton, a wizard at the royal court in his lifetime, and in his death time, ghost of Gryffindor Tower, was stripped of his wand before being locked in a dungeon, and was unable to magic himself out of his execution. And wizarding families were particularly prone to losing younger members, whose inability to control their own magic made them noticeable and vulnerable to muggle witch hunters. "Let the muggles manage without us," was the cry, as the wizards drew further and further apart from their non-magical brethren, culminating with the institution of the International Statute of Wizarding Secrecy in 1689, when wizard kind voluntarily went underground. Children being children, however, the grotesque hopping pot had taken hold of their imaginations. The solution was to jettison the pro-muggle moral but keep the warty cauldron. So by the middle of the 16th century, a different version of the tale was in wide circulation among wizarding families. In the revised story, the hopping pot protects an innocent wizard from his torch-bearing, pitchfork pitchfork toting neighbors by chasing them away from the wizard's cottage, catching them and swallowing them whole. At the end of the story, by which time the pot has consumed most of his neighbors, the wizard gains a promise from the few remaining villagers that he will be left in peace to practice magic. In return, he instructs the pot to render up its victims, who are duly burped out of its depths, slightly mangled. To this day, some wizarding children are only told the revised version of the story by their generally anti-muggle parents, and the original, if and when they ever read it, comes as a great surprise. As I have already hinted, however, its pro-muggle sentiment was not the only reason that the wizard and the hopping pot attracted anger. As the witch hunts grew ever fiercer, wizarding families began to live double lives, using charms of concealment to protect themselves and their families. By the 17th century, any witch or wizard who chose to fraternize with muggles became suspect, even an outcast in his or her own community. Among the many insults heard at pro-muggle witches and wizards, such few witty epithets as mother wallower, dung licker, and scumsucker date from this period, was the charge of having weak or inferior magic. Influential wizards of the day, such as Brutus Malfoy, editor of Warlock at War, an anti-muggle periodical, perpetuated the stereotype that a muggle lover was about as magical as a squib. A squib is a person born to magical parents, but who has no magical powers. Such an occurrence is rare. Muggle-born witches and wizards are much more common. J.K. Rowling notu gelmiş. In 1675, Brutus wrote, "This we may state with certainty. Any wizard who shows fondness for the society of muggles is of love intelligence, with magic so feeble and pitiful that he can only feel himself superior if surrounded by muggle pig men. Nothing is a surer sign of weak magic than a weakness for non-magical company." This prejudice eventually died out in the face of overwhelming evidence that some of the world's most brilliant wizards, such as myself, were, to use the common phrase, muggle lovers. Jesus, such as myself falan. Daha bu durum bu haller aşırı hoşuma gidiyor ya. Böyle kendini övüyor falan yani. Böyle beni affeder ama inanılmaz zekamı da işin içine katınca böyle bir şey yapabildim tarzı falan laflar ediyordu böyle. Hatırlıyorum birkaç yerde. Öyle, very good. The final objection to the wizard and the hopping pot remains alive in certain quarters today. It was summed up best, perhaps, by Beatrix Bloxon. Beatrix Lestrange'deki bazı harflerin yer değiştirme sonucu bu isim üretildiği çok belli değil mi sizce de? Bence öyle. 1794 to 1910. Are you fucking kidding me? 116 yaşında ölmüş. Author of the infamous Toadstool Tales. Mrs. Bloxon believed that the tales of Beedle-the-Bard were damaging to children because of what she called... Hemen geliyorum. Their unhealthy preoccupation with the most horrid subjects, such as death, disease, bloodshed, wicked magic, unwholesome characters and bodily effusions and eruptions of the most disgusting kind. Mrs. Bloxon took a variety of old stories, including several of Beedle's, and rewrote them according to her ideas, which she expressed as filling the pure minds of our little angels with healthy, hippie thoughts, keeping their sweet slumber free of wicked dreams and protecting the precious flower of their innocence. The final paragraph of Mrs. Bloxon's pure and precious reworking of the wizard and the hopping pot reads, "Then the little golden pot danced with the light, hoppity hoppity hop, on its tiny rosy toes. We weary kings had cured all the dollies of their poorly tum-tums, and the little pot was so happy that it filled up with sweeties for the Willikins and the Dollies. But don't forget to brush your teeth pegs, cried the pod. And we really kissed and huggled the hoppity pod and promised always to have the dollies and never to be an old grumpy wumpkins again. Grumpy wumpkins on. Not cool man, not cool diyor. Şu ekranı düzelsem düzeltmesem mi? İyi sanırım. Mrs. Bloxham's tale has met the same response from generations of wizarding children. Uncontrollable retching, followed by an immediate demand to have the book taken from them and mashed into pulp. Okay diyoruz. Bir Silteri yılanı, bir kılıç görüyoruz falan. Yani Silteri yılanı değil ama most probably yani. Başka ne var orada? Boncuk, çiçek, yaprak, yapraklar var. Okay. 2. The Fountain of Fair Fortune. F. Hani bu quick quotes, quill falan J.K. Rowling bunu yapıyor deyip durduk zaten. Evet, devam. High on a hill in an enchanted garden, enclosed by tall walls and protected by strong magic, flowed the Fountain of Fair Fortune. Once a year, between the hours of sunrise and sunset on the longest day, a single unfortunate was given the chance to fight their way to the fountain, bath in its waters and receive fair fortune for evermore. On the appointed day, hundreds of people traveled from all over the kingdom to reach the garden walls before dawn. Male and female, rich and poor, young and old, of magical means and without, they gathered in the darkness, each hoping that they would be the one to gain entrance to the garden. Three witches, each with her burden of woe, met on the outskirts of the crowd and told one another their sorrows as they waited for sunrise. The first, by name Usher, was sick of a malady no healer could cure. She hoped that the fountain would banish her symptoms and grant her a long and happy life. The second, by name Alteda, had been robbed of her home, her gold, and her wand by an evil sorcerer. She hoped that the fountain might relieve her of powerlessness and poverty. The third, by name Amata, had been deserted by a man whom she loved dearly, and she thought her heart would never melt. She hoped that the fountain would relieve her of her grief and longing. Pitying each other, the three women agreed that, should the chance befall them, they would unite and try to reach the fountain together. The sky was red with the first ray of sun, and a chink in the wall opened. The crowd surged forward, each of them striking their claim for the fountain's benison. Creepers from the garden beyond snaked through the pressing mass and twisted themselves around the first witch, Asha. She grasped the wrist of the second witch, Alteda, who seized tied upon the ropes of the third witch, Amata. And Amata became caught upon the armor of a dismal-looking knight who was seated on a bone-tin horse. Aklıma şey geldi, şu Don Quixote vari karakteri geldi bir anlığına. Şeyde, Sir Cadogan. The creepers tucked the three witches through the chink in the wall, and the knight was dragged off his steed after them. The furious screams of the disappointed throng rose upon the morning air, then fell silent as the garden walls sealed once more. Asha and Alteda were angry with Amata, who had accidentally brought along the knight. Only one can bathe in the fountain. It will be hard enough to decide which of us it will be without aiding another. Now, Sir Luckless, as the knight was known in the land outside the walls, observed that these were witches and having no magic, nor any great skill at jousting or dueling with swords, nor anything that distinguished the non-magical man, but sure that he had no hope of beating the three women to the fountain. He therefore declared his intention of withdrawing outside the walls again. At this, Amata became angry too. Faint heart, she chided him, draw your sword, knight, and help us reach our goal. And so the three witches and the forlorn knight ventured forth into the enchanted garden, where rare herbs, fruit, and flowers grew in abundance on either side of the sunlit paths. They met no obstacle until they reached the foot of the hill on which the fountain stood. Hani resmimiz bu lan. Şu resme biraz bakıp geleyim ben. Güzel bir resim. Devam. There, however, wrapped around the base of the hill, was a monstrous white worm, bloated and blind. At their approach, it turned a full face upon them, full, and uttered the following words. Pay me the proof of your pain. Sir Locklist drew his sword and attempted to kill the beast, but his blade snapped. Then Al-Hedda cast rocks at the worm, while Asha and Amata essayed every spell that might subdue or entrance it, but the power of their wands was no more effective than their friend's stone or the knight's steel. The worm would not let them pass. The sun rose higher and higher in the sky, and Asha, despairing, began to weep. Then the great worm placed its face upon hers and drank the tears from her cheeks. Its thirst assuaged, the worm slithered aside and vanished into a hole in the ground. Rejoicing at the worm's disappearance, the three witches and the knight began to climb the hill, sure that they would reach the fountain before noon. Halfway up the steep slope, hikaye aşırı hoşuma gitmeye başladı şu arada. Şu esnada bu arada diyecektim, evet. Böyle devam. Halfway up the steep slope, however, they came across words cut into the ground before them. Pay me the fruit of your labors. Sir Luckless took out his only coin and placed it upon the grassy hillside, but it rolled away and was lost. The three witches and the knight continued to climb, but though they walked for hours more, they advanced not a step. The summit came no nearer, and still the inscription lay in the earth before them. All were discouraged as their sun rose over their heads and began to sink towards the far horizon. But Al-Hedda walked faster and harder than any of them, and exhorted the others to follow her example, though she moved no further up the enchanted hill. Courage, friends, and do not yield, she cried, wiping the sweat from her brow. As the drops fell glittering onto the earth, the inscription blocking their path vanished, and they found that they were able to move upwards once more. Very good. Hikaye çok güzel gidiyor. Okay, devam. Delighted by the removal of this second obstacle, they hurried towards the summit as fast as they could, until at last they glimpsed the fountain glittering like crystal in a bower of flowers and trees. Before they could reach it, however, they came to a stream that ran round the hilltop, bearing their way, and the depths of the clear water lay a smooth stone bearing the words, pay me the treasure of your past. Sir Luckless attempted to float across the stream on his shield, but it sank. The three witches pulled him from the water and tried to leap the brook themselves, but it would not let them cross. And all the while, the sun was sinking lower in the sky. So they fell to pondering the meaning of the stone's message. And Amata was the first to understand. Taking her wand, she drew from her mind all the memories of happy times she had spent with her vanished lover and dropped them into the rushing waters. The stream swept them away and stepping stones appeared, and the three witches and the knight were able to pass at last onto the summit of the hill. The fountain shimmered before them, set amidst herbs and flowers rarer and more beautiful than any they had yet seen. The sky burned ruby, and it was time to decide which of them would bathe. Before they could make their decision, however, frail Asha fell to the ground. Exhausted by their struggle to the summit, she was close to death. Her three friends would have carried her to Anneyin ölüm yadigarları işareti var lan burada. Niye?
Aa bak bu enteresan işte. Ne alakası var? Üç kardeşin hikayesini şeydi bu. Jesus. Ben buna bir bakacağım. Belki bir şeyler buluruz. Have no idea. Devam.
The Phantom, but I was in mortal agony and begged them not to touch her. Then I'll tell the Heston to pick all those herbs she thought most hopeful, and mix them in Sir Luckless's gourd of water, and pour the potion into Asha's mouth. At once, Asha was able to stand. What was more, all symptoms of her dread malady had vanished. I'm cured, she cried. I have no need of the fountain. Let Altheda bathe. But Altheda was busy collecting more herbs in her apron. If I can cure this disease, I shall earn gold aplenty. Let Amata bathe. Sir Luckless bowled and gestured Amata towards the fountain, but she shook her head. The stream had washed away all regret for her lover, and she saw now that he had been cruel and faithless, and that it was happiness enough to be rid of him. Good sir, you must bathe as a reward for all your chivalry, she told Sir Luckless. So the knight clanked forth in the last rays of the setting sun and bathed in the fountain of fair fortune, astonished that he was the chosen one of hundreds and giddy with his incredible luck. As the sun fell below the horizon, Sir Luckless emerged from the waters with the glory of his triumph upon him, and flung himself in his rusted armor at the feet of Amata, who was the kindest and most beautiful woman he had ever beheld. Flushed with success, he begged for her hand and her heart, and Amata, no less delighted, realized that she had found a man worthy of them. She had found a man worthy of them. Bu ne demek anlamadım. Devam. The three witches and the knight set off down the hill together, arm in arm, and all four led long and happy lives. And none of them ever knew or suspected that the fountain's waters carried no enchantment at all. Güzel hikaye. Albus Dumbledore on the Fountain of Fair Fortune. The Fountain of Fair Fortune is a perennial favorite, so much so that it was the subject of the sole attempt to introduce a Christmas pantomime to Hogwarts's festive celebrations. Our then herbology master, Professor Herbert Beery, eventually left Hogwarts to teach at WVADA, Wizarding Academy of Dramatic Arts, where he once confessed to me he maintained a strong aversion to mounting performances of this particular story, believing it to be unlucky. He maintained a strong aversion. Şu aversion'a bir bakacağım. İsteksizlik, nefret, hoşlanmama, cırt diyor. He maintained a strong aversion to mounting performances of this particular story, believing it to be unlucky derken tam olarak neyden kastediyor anlamadım. Orden Herbology Master, Professor Herbert Beery, an enthusiastic devotee of amateur dramatics, proposed an adaptation of this well-beloved children's tale as a Yuletide thread for staff and students. I was then a young transfiguration teacher, and Herbert assigned me to special effects, which included providing a fully functioning fountain of fair fortune and a miniature grassy hill. Onun üstüne Dumbledore kendi çizmiş o zaman ölüm yerlerinin işaretini. Jesus. Included providing a fully functioning fountain of fair fortune and a miniature grassy hill, up which our three hero wives and hero would appear to march, while it sank slowly into the stage and out of sight. I think I may say without vanity that both my fountain and my hill performed the parts allotted to them with simple goodwill. Alas, that the same could not be said of the rest of my cast. Ignoring for a moment the antics of the gigantic warm, provided by our care of magical creatures teacher, Professor Sylvanus Kettleburn. The human element proved disastrous to the show. Professor Beery, in his role of director, had been dangerously oblivious to the emotional entanglements sitting under his very nose. Little did he know that the students playing Amata and Sir Locklus had been boyfriend and girlfriend until 1 hour before the curtain rose, at which point Sir Locklus transferred his affections to Usher, Jesus. Suffice it to say that our seekers after fair fortune never made it to the top of the hill. The curtain had barely risen when Professor Kettleburn's warm, now revealed to be an Ashwinder. See fantastic pieces and where to find them for a definitive description of this curious beast. Without never to be voluntarily introduced into a wood-paneled room, nor have an engorgement charm placed upon it. Okay, diyoruz. With an engorgement charm upon it, exploded in a shower of hot spark and dust, filling the great hall with smoke and fragments of scenery. By the enormous fiery axe it had laid at the foot of my heel ignited the floorboards. Amata and Asha turned upon each other, dueling so fiercely that Professor Beery was caught in the crossfire, and staff had to evacuate the hall, as the inferno now raging on stage threatened to engulf the place. The night's entertainment concluded with a packed hospital wing. It was several months before the great hall lost its pungent aroma of wood smoke, and even longer before Professor Beery's had reassumed its normal proportions, and Professor Kettleburn was taken off probation. Professor Kettleburn survived no fewer than 62 periods of probation during his employment as care of magical creatures teacher. His relations with my predecessor at Hogwarts, Professor Diput, were always strained, Professor Diput considering him to be somewhat reckless. By the time I became headmaster, however, Professor Kettleburn had mellowed considerably. Although there were always those who took the cynical view that with only one and a half of his original limbs remaining to him, he was forced to take life at a quieter pace. Okay, diyoruz. Headmaster Armando Diput imposed a blanket ban on future pantomimes, a prominent theatrical tradition that Hogwarts continues to this day. Headmaster Armando Diput imposed a blanket ban on future pantomimes, direkt yasaklamış. Our dramatic fiasco notwithstanding, The Fountain of Fair Fortune is probably the most popular of Beedle's tales, although just like The Wizard and the Hopping Pot, it has its detractors. More than one parent has demanded the removal of this particular tale from the Hogwarts library, including by coincidence, a descendant of Brutus Malfoy and one-time member of the Hogwarts Board of Governors, Mr. Lucius Malfoy. Mr. Malfoy submitted his demand for a ban on the story in writing. Any work of fiction or non-fiction that depicts interbreeding between wizards and muggles should be banned from the bookshelves of Hogwarts. I do not wish my son to be influenced into sullying the purity of his bloodline by reading stories that promote wizard-muggle marriage. My refusal to remove the book from the library was backed by a majority of the Board of Governors. I wrote back to Mr. Malfoy, explaining my decision. So-called pure-blood families maintain their alleged purity by disowning, banishing, or lying about muggles or muggle bones on their family trees. They then attempt to foist their hypocrisy upon the rest of us by asking us to ban works dealing with the trust truths they deny. There is not a witch or wizard in existence whose blood has not mingled with that of muggles, and I should therefore consider it both illogical and immoral to remove works dealing with the subject from our students' store of knowledge. My response prompted several further letters from Mr. Malfoy, But as they consisted mainly of opprobrious remarks on my sanity, parentage, and hygiene falan bile dedim yani. Hygiene. The relevance to this commentary is removed. This exchange marked the beginning of Mr. Malfoy's long campaign to have me removed from my post as headmaster of Hogwarts, and of mine to have him removed from his position as Lord Voldemort's favorite Death Eater. And of mine to have him removed from his position as Lord Voldemort's favorite Death Eater. My name, Dios. This exchange marked the beginning time, okay. Burası da bitiyor. Bu ne? Sazımız var, defterimiz var. Okey. Kılıcımız var, ışık gibi bir şeyimiz var. Anahtar var. Ha, kadeh. Işık değil, kadehimiz var. O zaman şarabımız var diyoruz. Okey. Three, the warlock's hairy heart. Buna başlamalı mı, başlamamalı mı? Olmadı hikayeyi bitireyim, okey. There was once a handsome, rich and talented young warlock who observed that his friends grew foolish when they fell in love, gambling and preening, losing their appetites and their dignity. The young warlock resolved never to fall prey to such weakness and employed dark arts to ensure his immunity. Unaware of his secret, the warlock's family loved to see him so aloof and cold. All will change, they prophesied, when a maid catches his fancy, but the young warlock's fancy remained untouched. Though many a maiden was intrigued by his haughty mien and employed her most subtle arts to please him, none succeeded in touching his heart. And employed her most subtle arts. Tam anlamadım burada. Young warlock's fancy remained untouched. Though many a maiden was intrigued by his haughty mien and employed her most subtle. Though many a maiden, hani bir sürü maiden'dan bahsediyor ama hala tek bir kişiymiş gibi her kullanmasını anlamadıydım ama kullanılıyormuş demek. Sonuçta though many a maiden, hani orada bir e kullanmış oldu. A bu durumda oluyor sanırım. And employed her most subtle arts to please him. None succeeded in touching his heart. The warlock gloried in his indifference and the sagacity that had produced it. The first freshness of youth waned, and the warlock's peers began to wed and then to bring forth children. Their hearts must be husks, he sneered inwardly as he observed the antics of the young parents around him, trifled by the demands of these meddling offspring. Devam. And once again, he congratulated himself upon the wisdom of his early choice. In due course, the warlock's aged parents died. Their son did not mourn them. On the contrary, he considered himself blessed by their demise. Now he reigned alone in their castle, having transferred his greatest treasure to the deepest dungeon. He gave himself over to a life of ease and plenty, and his comfort the only aim of his many servants. The warlock was sure that he must be an object of immense envy to all who beheld his splendid and untroubled solitude. Fierce were his anger and chagrin, therefore, when he overheard two of his lackeys discussing their master one day.
Hemen geliyorum. Devam.
The first servant expressed pity for the warlock who, with all his wealth and power, was yet beloved by nobody. But his companion jeered, asking why a man with so much gold and a palatial castle to his name had been unable to attract a wife. Their words dealt dreadful blows to the listening warlock's pride. He resolved at once to take a wife, and that she would be a wife superior to all others. She will possess astounding beauty, exciting envy and desire in every man who beheld her. She will spring from magical lineage, so that their offspring would inherit outstanding magical gifts. And she would have wealth at least equal to his own, so that his comfortable existence will be assured in spite of additions to his household. It might have taken the warlord 50 years to find such a woman. It so happened that the very day after he decided to seek her, a maiden answering his every wish arrived in the neighborhood to visit her kinsfolk. She was a witch of prodigious skill and possessed of much gold. Her beauty was such that it tugged at the heart of every man who set eyes on her, of every man that is except one. The warlord's heart felt nothing at all. Nevertheless, she was the prize he sought, so he began to pay her court. All who noticed the warlock's change in manners were amazed and told the maiden that she had succeeded where 100 had failed. The young woman herself was both fascinated and repelled by the warlock's attentions. She sensed the coldness that lay behind the warmth of his flattery and had never met a man so strange and remote. Her kinsfolk, however, deemed theirs a most suitable match and, eager to promote it, accepted the warlock's invitation to a great feast in the maiden's honor. The table was laden with silver and gold, bearing the finest wines and most sumptuous foods. Minstrels strummed on six-stringed lutes and sang of a love their master had never felt. The maiden sat upon a throne beside the warlock, who spake low, employing words of tenderness he had stolen from the poets, without any idea of their true meaning. The maiden listened, puzzled, and finally replied, "You speak well, warlock, and I will be delighted by your attentions, if only I thought you had a heart." The warlock smiled and told her that she need not fear on that score. Bidding her follow, he led her from the feast and down to the locked dungeon where he kept his greatest treasure. Jesus. Kullanmış lan kalbi. Jesus. Oğlum şu an aşırı şey oldum lan. Kendi kalbimi hissetmişim gibi oldum falan. Benim de var hani falan göremiyorum da böyle. Değişime gitti. Benim de kalbim var falan. Şurada bir yerde. O işte böyle şeyleri seviyor. Birden yok yere kendi halbimi falan hatırlıyor. Kalbimi. Halbimi mi dedi? Kendi kalbimi falan hatırlıyor. Anlatabiliyor muyum? Enteresan hikayeler olunca değişik işte. Devam. Here in an enchanted crystal casket was a warlock's beating heart. Long since disconnected from eyes, ears, and fingers, it had never fallen prey to beauty or to a musical voice, to the feel of silken skin. The maiden was terrified by the sight of it, for the heart was shrunken and covered in long black hair. Shrunken derken içine göçmüş gibi mi? Shrunk. Çekmiş, daralmış, daraltılmış, öyle sanırım. "Oh, what have you done?" she lamented. "Put it back where it belongs, I beseech you." Seeing that this was necessary to please her, the warlord gripped his wand, unlocked the crystal casket, sliced open his own breast, and replaced the hairy heart in the empty cavity it had once occupied. "Now you are healed and will know true love," cried the maiden, and she embraced him. The touch of her soft white arms, the sound of her breath in his ear, the scent of her heavy gold hair, all pierced the newly awakened heart like spears. But it had grown strange during its long exile, blind and savage in the darkness to which it had been condemned, and its appetites had grown powerful and perverse. The guests at the feast had noticed the absence of their host and the maiden. At first untroubled, they grew anxious as the hours passed, and finally began to search the castle. They found the dungeon at last, and a most dreadful sight awaited them there. The maiden lay dead upon the floor, her breast cut open, and beside her crouched the mad warlock, holding in one bloody hand a great, smooth, shining, scarlet heart, which he licked and stroked, vowing to exchange it for his own. Jesus.
Burada bir kendim bakıp gelmek istiyorum. Bu felaket kuvvetli var ya şurası. Yani diyecek başka hiçbir şey yok. Böyle tüylerim diken diken oldu yani. Yani olmadan öyle ifade edesim geldi. Aşırı kuvvetli yani.
In his other hand he held his wand, trying to coax from his own chest the shriveled, hairy heart. But the hairy heart was stronger than he was, and refused to relinquish its hold upon his senses or to return to the coffin in which it had been locked for so long. Before the horror-struck eyes of his guests, the warlord cast aside his wand and seized a silver dagger. Vowing never to be mastered by his own heart, he hacked it from his chest. For one moment, the warlord knelt triumphant with a heart clutched in each hand. Then he fell across the maiden's body and died.
Jesus. Jesus. Oğlum çok çok şiddetli bir şeyler okudum ben. Şu resme bakıp geliyorum ben. Okay, devam.
Albus Dumbledore on the warlock's hairy heart. Tam buraya geçmeden gayrı şu kaydı ben bir şey diyeyim, durdurayım.
Diyecek bir şey var mıdır düşünüp geliyorum. Nope, hadi görüşürüz.